Soy Antonio Jardín, presidente de Nagas, y hoy aquí, en tanto que presidente de FUNSEAM, agradezco a todos vosotros pues el interés por este seminario. Es el Autumn Seminar que organizamos cada año con FUNSEAM. Solemos hacerlo, como bien sabéis, pues utilizando las instalaciones de las empresas patronas que nos ceden, y hoy pues tenemos el honor de hacerlo aquí en Enagás, que ya os digo que a partir de ahora que es vuestra casa, bueno, tampoco os quedéis todo el día, que no sea que, pero bueno, no, es vuestra casa y estamos muy contentos de teneros aquí. Vamos a hablar de un tema que entendemos que forma parte de la espina dorsal de lo que FUNSEAM decidió ya hace algunos años hacer, que es relacionar los temas energéticos con la sostenibilidad y en concreto con el proceso de descarbonización de la economía. Y creo que FUNSEAM ahí pues fue muy clara, o sea, creo que vio claro que este era un camino que teníamos que tener. Hoy tenemos aquí un invitado especial para hablar en concreto y dentro de este mundo y de este proceso, los gases renovables, de los renovables no eléctricos, biometano, hidrógeno, etcétera. Y tenemos el honor de tener aquí con nosotros a Torben Bravo, el Chief Executive Officer del Transmission System Operator danés. Por lo tanto, para nosotros es un honor, y además es, en fin, lo va a explicar él mucho mejor que yo, uno de los países que a mi juicio en este momento está más adelantado precisamente en esta materia, ¿no? I'd really like to thank you, Torben, for accepting our invitation. It's a real pleasure to welcome you, and I am sure, all the assistants will be inspired and delighted by your speech shortly, ¿no? Realmente, Dinamarca, y en concreto el trabajo que Torben dirige, han conseguido hacer de que los gases renovables en este momento sean en su país, bueno, tengo aquí algunos datos, prácticamente el 10-11% del gas inyectado es un gas ya renovable, y tienen un objetivo para el año 2023, pues no sé, del 30%, me parece absolutamente maravilloso, y por lo tanto creo que vamos a aprender mucho. Nosotros tenemos en España una red potente de alta presión, más de 10-12 mil kilómetros. Estamos muy interesados en tirar esto adelante. Enagás, pues en concreto, FUNSEAM en general, y en concreto Enagás, que estamos aquí, pues trabajamos mucho en este terreno. Tenemos incluso una startup que de alguna manera, pues en fin, trabaja en esta dirección. Y bueno, pues por parte de todo el sector energético en general, del sector gasista en concreto, y de Enagás, pues la verdad es que estamos trabajando en esta línea. Aquí tanto Antón Martínez, nuestro director de transformación de energía, como Jesús Gil, nuestro director de nuevas energías, pues en fin, están por aquí, han podido mantener reuniones de trabajo, y en definitiva yo creo que para todos vosotros pues en fin va a ser interesante. Tengo que excusar, por cierto, a Maite Costa, María Teresa Costa, la doctora Costa, que por razones personales no ha podido finalmente desplazarse a Madrid, pero pienso que el seminario, después del pequeño refrigerio que hemos hecho, pues va a funcionar muy bien. Y yo casi pues nada más agradeceros vuestra presencia aquí, decir que va a ser Joan Batalla, el director general de FUNSEAM, el que va a introducir correctamente y con todos los datos a nuestro invitado, y después pues vamos a escuchar a nuestro amigo, y pues en fin, debateréis lo que sea necesario. Sabéis que estos seminarios que organiza anualmente FUNSEAM creo que nos sirven para poner en común datos, digámosle datos técnicos, reflexión desde la academia, preocupaciones de los reguladores, y nos están siendo muy útiles, y por lo tanto pues este es un elemento más. Y sin más, yo pues termino, os agradezco vuestra presencia, os invito a volver a venir, en fin, a la casa de Enagás, pues siempre que os parezca oportuno, y bueno, pues a nuestro invitado le cedo la palabra, y bueno, se la cedo primero a Joan Batalla para hacer el orden bien hecho. Muchas gracias, hasta ahora.
Muchas gracias, presidente. La verdad es que como Funseam es un placer estar aquí hoy con todos vosotros en estos seminarios que con carácter trimestral realizamos alrededor de temas de relevancia para el sector. Y obviamente el tema de los gases renovables no es una excepción. Creemos que existe una enorme oportunidad a la hora de facilitar la descarbonización de lo que es la matriz energética. Permitidme que continúe en inglés por Torben. Sabéis ya, si habéis asistido a algún otro seminario, que el formato será, pues tras esta breve introducción mía de 5 minutos, vendrá la presentación de Torben. Y con toda libertad, pues me ha pedido el tema de que, dado que es una reunión de trabajo, de jornada, pues simplemente que le interrumpáis, sin necesidad incluso el tema de que debamos esperar a la fase final de debate. As I was explaining before, for us it's a very important seminar, even the topic, and especially also for Enagás, that is, this seminar takes place in a very special year for Enagás, as you know. It's the 50th year of the arrival of the natural gas to Spain. In February 1969, the ship Aristotle from Algeria, it was the first ship that was allowing liquefying natural gas in Spain, in Barcelona, in the regasification plan of Barcelona. So 50 years of success of the natural gas in Spain, given its importance in for the economy and for the energy security of supply, and able to provide fuel that is really important for the future and for the competitiveness of the economy. But today we are not talking about the past. I think that is more relevant to talk about the future and the future of the natural gas. As you know, the future is marked by an energy transition process that is really ambitious. In Europe, in Spain, there are a lot of relevant and significant decarbonization targets for the sector. And we consider that the natural gas will indeed contribute to the transition process. The climate change requires urgent action, as discussed these days in New York. And the challenge is to carry out the required transition towards a greener future with the participation of all energies, and being able to provide affordable energy, able to guarantee this decarbonized future and also the competitiveness of the economy. And in this sense, we consider that the availability of well-developed gas networks in Europe, and especially in Spain, and the complementary function that these networks could do with the renewable gas make infrastructure well-positioned to meet this challenge. And just to talk about that, we have today Torben Bravo. Thank you for accepting our invitation to participate in this seminar. Mr. Bravo will address during his presentation the future of gas and renewable gases, how to reduce the carbon footprint of the natural gas mix and the European gas infrastructure grid potential of integration renewable energy. The president was explaining before the relevance of the Danish energy system in terms of integration of renewables. Torben Bravo is the chief executive officer of the gas TSO in the joint Danish gas and power TSO, EnergyNet. He has 25 years of experience in the energy and gas sector in Denmark and abroad. Prior to joining EnergyNet, he took part in the European Power and Gas Project as part of the liberalization of the Danish gas market in 2002-2004. And as the current CEO in EnergyNet, Torben is highly involved in the European gas projects. Different initiatives, for instance, Gas Infrastructure Europe, EMSOG, the European Network of Gas TSOs, and the European Gas Capacity Trading Platform, Prisma. And also he managed several decarbonization initiatives such as the Green Gas Initiative, that some of the results will be present today. Sincerely, we consider that is the best person just to talk about the relevance of the natural gas and the renewable gas in the future energy system. Thank you again for accepting our invitation, and without more delay, Torben, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Yes. think I should take this one. So thank you for inviting me. It was a great pleasure to be invited. I didn't hesitate at all. I said yes. For me, it's about coming around in Europe and discuss about my situation and my cases and to listen about what's the situation in other countries. And I have had some good meetings with some of Enagas focus people on the green energies. I guess I work one third of my time in Brussels on the European markets and development of green gases or capacity platforms, etc., and then two-thirds back home. And for me, it's important to be and define, together with the Commission or the regulators, also what is being done from Brussels. 10 years ago, I could decide myself in Denmark. 100% of the Danish market we decided without the European Union. And today, I guess, we can only decide less than 20%. 80% is coming from Brussels. And that means that we need to be in Brussels, we need to talk to our neighbors and make coalitions so we can, let's say, impact how legislation is coming upon us. You mentioned that I was the best speaker for you today. That will be a judgment for you to make afterwards. So I'm at least, I guess I'm relevant to be here. And then I've taken some topics in my presentation, and I made them specially for you. I don't have a speech because part of my conclusion is that everything is going so fast. So 3 years back, I have read all materials about biomethane made within the gas sector. And today, I don't even look for the papers because there's so much coming about biomethane and methanization of hydrogen, hydrogen power to gas, sector coupling, etc. So I think also that's one of our successes, that things are evolving so quickly. So I come from a Danish state-owned company. It's Energinet. We are defined by law, and we are an infrastructure company. So we own a lot of the infrastructure within the energy sector in Denmark. So we are the power TSO, that's the two companies to the left, and then I'm in the middle, the gas TSO. Then we have gas storages, gas distribution, and then we have a data hub. So we do a lot of, let's say, IT development. So for the power sector, as an example, all the data on all production and consumption is within our computer. So we have taken all the computers from all the distribution networks and taken all the data into our national computer. And that means that we are sitting on all the data in the electricity sector. So it's very easy for us to develop the markets, to prepare, let's say, green layers on top of the markets, to make, let's say, interconnections with Sweden or Germany or Norway, because we already have the data. So for me, another conclusion is that data, IT, and digitalization is part of the transition that we are going through. For me, it's about climate. It's about the Paris 2050 goals. I saw that Enagas, you have also these United Nations societal goals on your homepage, and you're also coming from there. So as a state-owned company, my owner wants us to fulfill the Paris Agreement 2050. And that makes it easier for me as a gas company or player in the energy sector, because the government have decided that we should be 100% green in 2050. And the new government have decided that in 2030 we will be 70% green. And the gas sector will probably be above 70. And currently we are only 10, 11, 12% biomethane in our annual mix. So it means that we will go from 11% to higher than 70 in 11 years. And I hope to be there in 11 years. So I will go on pension in 20 years from now. So I expect to deliver on the 2030, which is also important. There's two ways to meet the Paris goals. One is to switch heavy sulfur oil and coal into natural gas and have a very fast steep decline. And then there's the rest, meeting the goals in the 2050. And by meeting the goals in 2050, it's not about energy. It's about everything. Everything in this room is prepared from energy or from products which is coming from carbons, hydrocarbons. And that means that in 2050, we will need to furnish this room without the hydrocarbons. So for me, it's both about energy, electricity, but it's also about all the other stuff that we are surrounding us with. Actually, we started some years ago. 45 years ago, we started by pushing for wind developments or onshore wind farms. And that's the reason why that, in accordance to the IEA, we are the country in the world with having the highest wind production in our annual consumption. It's a rock. It's approximately 50% today. And Spain is right here. So you are another one of the world leads in introducing renewable energy into your energy mix. And that means that's one of the main reasons why I said yes so quick to come here, because I think that what I'm going through and what you are going through is in fact very similar. We have a difficult political setup, a different legislation, we have different geography, etc. But how we are in the penetration of renewable is fairly similar, so we have something to learn from each other. Depending on whether you have just started with 1% renewable energy or you have 10 or 20, or in our case 50, it means that some of the steps, the easy steps, we have already been through. In fact, it was very easy to go to 20% or 30%. And then it was a bit more difficult to go to 40 and 50%. And in my company, we say, okay, now we need the last 50%, which is even worse. They're very difficult. And that's why I link it to IT, because to be honest, brain power and hardware, that's not enough. We need to be very open to what we're doing with the energy sector, legislation, regulation, use of data, etc. And then depending on how much renewable energy you have, again, according to the IEA, then you have different tools in the toolbox. So the toolboxes that we are using in our country right now and the ones you're using and the ones down here, those are different. So for the last 18 months, how we included more and more renewable electricity in our company was about computer systems. It was how we, based on meteorological data, could make the forecast of where is the wind. Because if we know where the wind is, then we can balance easier and cheaper. So reaching the 50% as we have now is in fact much cheaper than what we expected 10 years ago. Because 10 years ago, we didn't have the tools available that we have now. So there's also some, let's say, some positive in the future, that there will be some of the steps which will be easier or cheaper than we expect. I brought this, which is the European Union gas package. The European Union, and especially with the new Commission, they want to change the energy system. And they for the gas sector, they do it with something called the gas package, which will probably be changed with the new Commission. But I use it also because the Commission have three focuses. One focus is that we take what have been done with the electricity sector and simply copy paste it to the gas sector. So the legal text and regulation for the power sector should be fitted into us. Then they look into the gas market, the internal market, how we can refine the markets. We have now for 15 years had a good liberalized market, which is almost perfect, and we can probably make it even more perfect, and that's the second pillar. And then the third pillar, that's about the future role of gas. Thank you. How are we going to use gas in the future, and what markets should be around that? And when I talk to people, we look on the three pillars differently. So the Commission, they want to do all three. So they want to do one-third there, one-third there, and one-third there. When I talk to the regulators, they think that this is very easy. It's a low-hanging fruit. It's just copy-paste. And then the regulators, and if there's any regulators in the room, it's okay. I really like regulators. But I also have to conclude that regulators like markets. So they will solve this equation from left to right. And in my company, we argue that we should solve the equation from right to left. I will use very little time in my country improving the market. We have a very good market. We lift hundreds of terawatt hours across the borders on a yearly basis. And we have done this within silos. So the gas market for me is that I talk to you, or primarily the gas experts in the room, and to my other neighbors, and I talk to the regulator, and the regulator, they have a department for gas and a department for electricity, and I go to the ministry, and there they also have departments for electricity and gas. And then we can continue talking power people to power people and gas people to gas people, but in my opinion, it doesn't bring me to 2050. So we need to look what is the future system, how is it going to be connected, what are the energy sources, and what are the consumptions. And then when we know that, then we can make a new regulation. And for sure, if there's something relevant to copy-paste from the power sector, it's fine for me. But again, the Commission have a work plan, but how the different stakeholders want to be engaged in this work plan, that's different. I must admit that during the last 3 years here in Madrid, the Madrid Forum for the Gas Sector, the Gas Regulatory Forum, is hosted here in Madrid. The regulators have changed. So if I go 5 years back, the regulators used 1% of their time on this, 1%. And now I guess they use between 20 and 40%. So even the regulators and the governments and the ministries, they are also changing their view on what are the main, what are the core topics, which is very positive. So I have one of the pictures of the future energy system, and I guess that you have seen others, and I bring this because it's very simple, in fact, and it's almost like a child have drawn it. It's very simple pictures. So I have a gas system, and I have an electricity system, and I have a heat system, and I have some production, and I have some consumption over here. And today, we have, let's say, primarily based energy system, which is fossil fuels, and we have usage of energy here, out here, which is fairly classical. And in my country, when we are looking on this, all of these boxes will have to change within the box until 2050. So today we have industries. I don't know where they are. They are probably here. Industries and power plants. We have residential houses, which is the three core segments of the gas consumption, natural gas consumption. And in the future, I know that it will be wind and solar. So I will lose the market for power plants in my country. And they also know it. So I have accepted that the gas consumption in power plants will decline. And at some point, it could be zero. The power sector have a problem with peak power. So for sure, there will be gas-fired power plants. But in my country, I don't know how much they will actually run. And then when there is a crisis or a period with no sun or wind, then they will run, because then we have a lack of power. The households here, that's the same. My government think that households, small consumers, they should have electricity. So we will also see a decline in the natural gas consumption for households. In some cases, we will have installation of hybrid heat pumps, where you, next to a gas boiler, you will have a heat pump, and then you will use the heat pump 10 months per year. And then when it's very cold and the power price is very high, then we will take the gas. So again, it's the same capacity needed, but the volume sold over the year is much lower, as was the case for the power plants. And that means that my tariff structure needs to change. Because if I continue relying on volume payments and there's very little volume, then I lose money. And I'm not interested in losing money. So one of the main topics for me is tariffs and regulation around my costs should also be changed. Then we have biomethane up here. So we have today more than 30 biomethane plants. We have 10, 11, 12% of the Danish gas consumption, which is coming from biomethane. And that will grow over the next 4 years. It will be doubled or even threefold. So we will reach 25 or 30% of the Danish gas consumption will come from biomethane. Another aspect in the future, which the power sector cannot solve themselves, that's storing of energy. For sure, there will be a lot of batteries. for hours, for days, but batteries for weeks, months, seasons, or emergency storages that will probably be some kind of gas. So this is a question, so I don't know whether you see the same future. And perhaps it doesn't matter right now, but I think it's very important that the ones which is your customers, that you have the same picture, and your regulators, that you see the same future, because otherwise, how should we engage with each other? Some of the countries, let's say, have different focus in this drawing. So in my country, we have a focus in this corner. We have very cheap wind available offshore. So the government, by saying 70% of this drawing should be green in 2050, they want the entire electricity sector to be green in 2030. So it's 100% power sector green in 2030. And it's offshore wind. So in my country, we'll see a push from this. In other countries, if I go to Netherlands or Germany, they're very strong on the industrial side over here. And there we see a pull, because the owners of these industries, they will, over time, need to be green in their energy supplies. I feel it in my country. A lot of my biggest consumers were the ones who started the pull for biomethane. So they said, we are producing, in my country, we are producing Lego bricks, you know, probably for kids. That's one of our good selling products. And the producers of Lego bricks knew that they cannot sell Lego bricks to families who are more and more aware on climate and ecological things. So they wanted to have gas supplied from green gases to a larger and larger extent, so they can say in their annual accounts and to their consumers that it's, in fact, a real green product that they are selling. Some of the others, if I go, for instance, to Dairy, we have an ice cream factory. They are not even satisfied with biomethane. They want to have the manure from ecological farms. So there we have a pull from an industry which is not only this. They want to have this circle categorized into different segments, because biomethane in itself is not green enough. They want to have the ecological part of the green. Why am I saying this? I will try to bring some, let's say, bring the facts further. If you have any questions, you can ask them now, because I know we have 30 minutes for questions. And for me, it's equally fair that we take them along the presentation as afterwards. It's up to you. So we were here, a lot of renewable electricity. So these are the ENSOC and ENSOE TYNDP's 10-year network development plans. And they say that in European Union, on average, there will be this penetration of renewable wind and solar share of electricity consumption. And these scenarios are here, 30, 35, and 40. And then we have taken the same data just for those countries, Germany, Netherlands, UK, and Denmark. And you can see that we are above as a group of countries. So me and my neighbors up north, we have higher percentages. So in 2040, we will have 70%, whereas in Europe, in average, it will only be 50%. I just told you before that in my country, in 30, we will have 100%. And that means that the trajectories, how we implement the transition, is different in the different countries. We have different starting points, but our end goals will also have different tick marks. And that means that already by 2030, we will have a lot of hours where we produce wind electricity and we don't need it. Because if we should have energy enough for the entire year, means that we need to have a peak capacity of wind production which is far higher than our needs. So our story I will show here, this is a price curve. I hope you like or love price curves. So it's ranked. So in a normal market situation, we have that it's very expensive in some hours, and then we have some baseload production. It could be coal or gas, and then we have the renewables pressing it down. But what we see in my country is that we will have a pressure where we will have prices having a curve, for instance, like the red one. And that means that by 2030, no, 2040, we will have one-third of the hours being negative. So one-third of the hours in the power market, the prices are negative. You pay to produce. It's free to consume. And one-third of the hours, it's close to zero. And then we will have some hours where there is a good marginal price. And that for sure means that we have a lot of electricity. Our neighbors will love it. They will just take it for free because we cannot consume anymore. And this is where one of these sector coupling conversion topics, the power to gas or electrolyzers, come in. So if we insert electrolyzers in the Danish network, we will push the price curve up here. So we will maintain the electricity within our own country. So it's good. So we convert very cheap electricity into gas, which we then can take further. I can already feel now that my presentation, you can feel, is, let's say, for technicians, it's for politicians, it's for regulators. But it's also important that the storyline that you have in your country or in your company, that you can use the same storyline for all the stakeholders. You cannot for the ministry says, I want natural gas to be maintained, and for the industry says, I will produce green gas. At some point, the stakeholders, they will discover that you don't have a unique storyline. So for me, it's very simple because we have the same storyline, and it doesn't matter whether I'm here in Spain or whether I'm talking to the minister or to our biggest clients. It's the same they see, they get. 1.5 years ago, Euroelectric, which is the Association of Power Producers, for the first time came with an analysis where in 2050 they showed that blue one, that's electricity. They showed that, in their opinion, electricity will not be everything. Until this report, all of us were convinced that electrification were the sole solution to our problem. Everything could be electrified. Some of the cleverest of you knew that that could not happen because some industrial uses where you have a lot of heat, some uses for airplanes or ships, you cannot have motors. So if you should have a battery for a big container ship, you should have four ships next to it with the battery for the one ship, and they should have ships with batteries. But this is the first time that the power sector said that there is probably a limit to how much that can be electrified. And then suddenly all of us, and in particular the politicians, they discovered, okay, but now we have for 10 years supported the power sector, and I love the power sector. This is not against the power sector. But the fact is that until this day, most of the political legislation were assisting the power sector because the power sector should be changed. They had the majority of subsidies. A lot of sub-legislation around the power sector, for instance, electric vehicles, that was perfectly functioning. And now they discovered that that was probably not the right path for them because they also need to do a lot of work on other fuels. And then gases, natural gas or green gases, could constitute a big part of this. So being here in Madrid for this Madrid Forum, I know that the day after this report came out, the Commission had changed their mind. I could feel that now they knew that they could not reach 2050 without having, let's say, a deal with the gas sector, because the gas sector is part of the problem solution taking care of this area up here. Next step, under the headline of we are not different, so I hope that you can follow, so I will not repeat anything and I will building up, and then the final slide we will say, oh, that was what it was all about. We're different. So ENSOG, ENSOG, they have prepared that until 2050, the primary energy mix due to energy efficiency, etc., will come down. And you also saw it here because this is the total European primary energy consumption, which will decrease. So the biggest solution for the future, that's not to use energy. And then comes electricity, and then there's other fuels. So NSOG, they had this. They are also using the commission's data. But then they made this. It's an internal graph, and it never, let's say, reached the end product. But the conclusion is that in some countries, you will see a gas demand decline 40%. That's me. In my country up here, I will probably have a demand decline of 40%. That's part of the solution. Other countries, they will have an increase in gas demand because you have a composition where you probably use a lot of nuclear or coal, as Germany does today, and the only solution for those two problems, that will be gases. Then there's the difference whether it's natural gas. Some of the countries over here in Eastern Europe, they are on the first curve I showed from the IPCC, from the climate panel. They are the best, let's say, assistance in the climate change because they convert coal to gas and they do it now, meaning that the next 30 years they will not emission CO2. Us, who is coming very late, we will emission fossil carbon dioxides until then. So each country have a different pathway in front of them. Many organizations, I'm part of this Green Gas Initiative, is Northwestern Europe. I know Spain is part of the Gas for Climate Initiatives, and we have more or less the same study results. And that is by using the gas system as we now know we need, the European community can save a lot of money. So our study showed that between 300 to 1,000 billion euros can be saved by using the gas system, and the other study is much more positive. So each of the countries have now assessed individually within my country what is the usage of the gas system, what's the socioeconomic value. I don't know whether you know this, it's a Dutch report. In the Netherlands, they made last year an infrastructure outlook, and it was the two TSOs. Is there anyone from the power TSO here in the room? No? Okay. But the power TSO in the Netherlands and the gas TSO in the Netherlands, they voluntarily made a study. Until this date, they had 10-year network development plans. The gas system should develop, the power sector should develop, and then they made a joint study. And the interesting thing about this is that they made a lot of different scenario assessments, and they ended up with three archetypes of future energy systems. They looked on the electricity, pure electricity system, where electricity wins. They looked on the methane system, which is natural gas, and then they looked on the hydrogen system. So the two TSOs assessed what should be the network which was best for the Netherlands in 2050. And the conclusion is, which is very good, and that is the best network for the Netherlands, that's not what the power TSO said before, and it's not what the gas TSO said before. So the best, the optimal network, that's a new network which none of them had discussed before. Because they were working in these silos, power sector with power sector people, gas sector with gas sector people. And now suddenly they saw and they admitted that the power sector cannot solve all problems. And the gas sector in some parts of the Netherlands, they need to accept that there will be a demand decline. And thus the optimal use of the networks is different. I don't know how many of you is familiar with hydrogen, but hydrogen has a long history in the Netherlands and in Germany. Both Netherlands, Belgium, and Germany, they have the two first countries, 1,000 kilometers pipeline of hydrogen, and in Germany they also have 1,000 kilometers of pipeline. So the big refineries, the big industrial users of energy already use hydrogen. And in the Netherlands, they now have the situation where they're going to close the biggest gas field, the Groningen field, very fast. So they need a new fuel or energy carrier very fast. So they will convert some of their existing gas networks into hydrogen. So they will have a push for hydrogen. So the Dutch government have made a hydrogen strategy where they link hydrogen to electricity and to methane gas. I don't know what would happen in Spain. let's say that the power and gas TSOs made a similar study, and you saw how should the networks be in the future. I don't know whether Enagas, and it's not an accusation, I don't have it myself, I would like to have, but in my network plan, I don't assess power. And in my sister company network plan, the power TSO, they don't assess gas. And I think that's wrong. So I think very soon, either voluntarily or by legislation, the European Commission or the regulators should press us to have, let's say, joint integrated network analysis. Another case is from France, and that's where the power TSO have made a demonstration site. Yeah, please. Yes. 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 Yes to all your questions. So I missed some detail. So in the Netherlands, they have 1,000 kilometers hydrogen network. And a lot of the development coming now will be offshore wind parks going onshore, electrolyzers producing hydrogen into dedicated hydrogen networks. They have even taken a methane pipeline and converted it into a hydrogen network. You can blend, and I just discussed with some of the Enagas colleagues, how much can we blend? Right now, we don't know. And it's one of those very steep learning curves. So in my country today, I have a test plant facility where in real pressure, high pressure and distribution network, we have taken 200 meters out of the network, demand declined. So we had an M&R station, which was not used. So we have 100 meters transmission, 100 meters distribution, and an M&R station connected via a new pipeline and an electrolyzer producing hydrogen. And today, we test at 15%. So legally, we can go up to 19% in Denmark. It's not in our rules. We only accept, I think, 3% at current. But legally, I could go to 19%. And right now, we are testing base load 3 months of 15%. So we started with 1%, then 3%, 6%, 9%, 12%. Now we're at 15%. And I think we will continue until 21%. And again, it's a very good success story because we had these 200 meters and my cleverest engineers, they called me crazy that I wanted to test it there. And they were very concerned. So we have 300 places where we on these 200 meters detect whether there are any leakage of hydrogen, because hydrogen is a very small molecule compared to methane. And therefore, this small molecule can leave out of valves, rubber bands, etc. But in fact, very few places there were detection. And where there were detection was because that the valve was 25 years old, etc. So we could probably fairly cheap retrofit the existing network to have hydrogen 10, 15, 20% in parts of our country. It's one of the pathways. They didn't assess this. This study is not about blending. It's only about pure methane, pure electricity, pure hydrogen, and then mix in between. Blending is not part of this. Blending will be in our study when we do it in our country. We will have some blending. And the reason why we have blending is that we don't have the hydrogen network as they have in the Netherlands. So they have an opportunity that I don't have in my country. Yes? Yes? No, it's hydrogen. Yes, they do in the Netherlands, and we will do it in my country. And the reason why, it's a very good question, because even though that the molecule is so small, now you can hear I'm an economist, and the methane molecule is so big, the value of the hydrogen is much higher than the value of natural gas. So by having the hydrogen network, you maintain a high value of the product, meaning that you can go to industries, meaning that you can go to transport sector and get 3, 4, 5 times more per energy content of the hydrogen. If you blend it into methane, you suddenly lose that value. please remember that on top of that you have the green value, the guarantees of origin value, because now I'm only talking about energy, but there's also the possibility that you can blend, and then it is green, so you will get a higher value for hydrogen, green hydrogen in a methane blended system. Now, yes. Yes, electrolyzers. Yes, so in this case, it's power to gas. In this case, it's not blue hydrogen. It's not, let's say, hydrogen extracted out of natural gas, which other countries can also do. They are doing it right now. 96% of the EU hydrogen market is blue hydrogen, and 4% is green. I cannot answer more questions about the Dutch case. Then I can send you the link with the report, because it's 1 year ago I read it, and if I give you more answers, it will probably be incorrect. But for me, it's, let's say, kind of guidance. I think all the countries should do this exercise and find out what is the optimal solution. I guess what would happen here in Spain is that the politicians will suddenly find out that they cannot only have a development over here. They need to have a broader perspective. And there will in the future be connection of different energy carriers, much more complex than what we're used to. France, they're doing demonstration projects. I will not say more about that. In the Netherlands, the Dutch TSO, they have made this, Gasunie, which is how hydrogen in the gas system will develop until 2035. A lot of projects, even storages, etc. This regional government up here has now given 2.8 billion euro for investment support into hydrogen infrastructure here. So the regional governments have a problem. They will in the future miss natural gas, and they need to find a new solution. That's where the money then comes from. But again, big changes also requires money. I brought this slide also because for me it's also about that in the end energy should be produced where it's most economic. And until this slide, all of us believed that energy, green energy, should be produced in our own country. And to be honest, I don't believe in that. I think in the end we will have new, let's say, main producers of renewable energy. And there will be a global market where the renewable energy will be transported around as we see today. And that's why I'm glad that both Gazprom and Norway, the two biggest producers of natural gas to Europe, that they are already now assessing a decarbonized future. Equinor, they are the most, let's say, advanced. They have 20, 30, 40, 50 goals. They want to be almost fully decarbonized by 2050. Meaning that they will, in this case, they have projects where they capture carbon and store it, that you can take the carbon out of the natural gas and then export the gas without the carbon content. They have a project where they have an aquifer where they can store enormous amounts of CO2. They are now, today, I saw this presentation again here in Madrid, that they are in contact with 15 big industries on the northwestern European shore side, and they want to co-invest with the industries a carbon capture at the utility, so not at the production side, but down where the gas, natural gas, is consumed. So on site, they will extract the carbon, put it on a carbon ship, and transport the carbon to Norway and store it. This is very expensive. This is going to cost a lot of losses for Equinor. But if they don't fix this problem, no one will buy gas from Equinor in 20, 40, or 50. So they have to invest enormous amounts of money. And I was very pleased to see that even Gazprom last November came with a decarbonization. It was not a strategy. It was a dialogue document. So Gazprom has made a decarbonization of Russian gas in three steps, and they sent it to Europe. It was a public paper, and the European politicians, they can look at it. Step one is coal to gas, and then they have a much more advanced view on this. The Russians, they are much more technical guys and girls. They are into pyrolysis, so they will have pyrolysis of natural gas, so they will extract the carbon as a solid, and then they will have the gas without the carbon. It's also very expensive. In my country, I guess in your country, if you go back in history books, we all had pyrolysis when we used it for industrial purposes in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and then it became ineconomic. It might be economic in the future. So it could be in the end that green energy will come from the existing producers. It could be, I also saw this study, that if you took 9% of Sahara and converted into solar panels, 9%, it produced the same amount as the entire European energy consumption. And I guess someone in Northern Africa or in Spain will develop solar panels and convert it into liquids and start selling it to the neighbors. We will also be part of this. So my government believes that we will be, let's say, selling hydrogen or other products based from wind. So that's why we are exploring and developing offshore wind. Should I look at the time?
Perfect.
Yeah. Time. You don't know how many slides I have, but I think it's perfect. We are more than halfway through, almost two thirds. Until now, I only talked about energy system production, transport, but also important is the appliances side, because if again I went to a big CCGT owner 4 years ago and said, I will have hydrogen in my gas, they would say, no, you shouldn't do that. And if I told them I will have more than 50% hydrogen up to 100% in a dedicated pipe, they would say, you should definitely not do this. You're crazy. You should not have your job. But what have happened since is that many of the industrial associations in Europe and in the world, they are now feeling that there is a change coming. So, for instance, EU Turbines, which is all the world's biggest producers of turbines, they prepared this spring a strategy for decarbonization. So until now, this is the Siemens case. Siemens, they have all these turbine types in these sizes. I'm an economist. I accept it. This is the truth. It's their own slide. Their most popular ones only take, let's say, up to 5 or 10% hydrogen. They can actually do it. If they do it, they have, let's say, a decline in the efficiency of the power plant. But what the EU Turbines Organization, they said, they have two statements. One is that in 2020, all numbers will at least be 20%. So the turbine manufacturers promises the turbine owners that they could receive 20% hydrogen in the mix in 2020 by upgrading software or cheap retrofitting of the turbines. And again, I was sitting in the room when they presented it, and all the owners of the turbines were also in the room, and they didn't walk. They stayed in the room and they nodded. So I expect that the turbine producers have now convinced the turbine owners, the power producers, that in the future there will be hydrogen. So that was the first statement. The second statement is that they say in 2030 they aim at 100% hydrogen optionality. And that means that all these different types, there will probably have new types, will have up till 100% possible usage of hydrogen. It comes in two versions. One version, that's a pure hydrogen turbine. And that's most efficient because it's produced to only produce hydrogen. And then they have the flexible turbine, which can take both natural gas and hydrogen. And that's less efficient. When they had this presentation, then the network owners, the distribution network owners, they came with a presentation and they said, because of this development, we are now started, and I'm talking about all gas distribution companies in the European Union, they have now started projects where they assess where they should insert digital meters in the gas network. So in the future, the owners of turbines or appliances, they will know what is the type of gas that they are receiving. So they will get an alert, let's say, on a real-time basis or every fifth minute, that now we are having an hydrogen content of 5, 10, 30%, and then the equipment automatically changed its setup so it can have a very high efficiency on this new gases mix. And for me, that's also fantastic because gas is a very simple product. In fact, we can do a lot with gases without IT. So this is one of the first places where I really see that IT data and digitalization will be part of the future. So we will detect what is the gas that is coming around. Even the fantastic biomethane have some problems. Biomethane have a higher oxygen content than normal natural gas. And that means that we have some concerns in Denmark for some of the industrial users that they would rather know that biomethane is coming. So on our homepage, or we have also made it as an IPA that we just sent them data, they get real-time updates about the oxygen content in the gas. So they can install their production equipment to receive gas with a higher oxygen content. We haven't solved the problems with the Germans. Germany don't want oxygen in the gas. And in some hour days, we export gas to Germany with higher oxygen. And that's why I use one third of my time in Brussels. Because if now one member state, a neighbor, says to the other, I will not accept your green gas, then we have a big problem. In the end, we all need to accept the same types of gases with a larger variety than what we have today. And the solution is for sure working together in Brussels, together with technical guys and experts. So now I'm coming back to my own country. Now I started with my own country, told you about the different system components. And this is one of our latest slides that we have. And this is, in fact, coming from the Gas and Power TSO. And it's talking about, so it's the same future picture as I had before, but we have inserted other, let's say, topics which is relevant for the discussions with the politicians and our stakeholders. So we are talking about power to gas. And power to gas has its limitations. So in my country, we will need a lot of fuels, liquids, which is not gases. So either I went into that sphere and became an expert also in liquids, or someone else would take that segment. So we are talking about, until now, electrolysis, where you produce this, which is hydrogen. And then we have biomethane production here, where you produce carbon. So the newest biomethane facility in Denmark we have, we produce biomethane, but we extract the carbon at the facilities. So it's carbon-free biomethane going into the network. And then we take the carbon and store it next to the biomethane plant. And right now, that carbon dioxide is sold to Carlsberg breweries. You probably know them. They make beer. Mm. It's a Danish company. And now they are putting carbon dioxide into their beer, which is an excess product of biomethane production. We see that the next biomethane plants coming in, they will also extract carbon. It's more expensive, but it means that you have another product that you can sell. And then we have the last component, which is this, which is nitrogen. And we also see that some of the end consumptions, for instance, within ships or airplanes, we don't expect that we can have a gas airplane, a gas-borne airplane. We think that it should be a liquid fuel that will go into the biggest ships and into airplanes. And so does the airplane producers. And that could be ammonia, which is made out of nitrogen and hydrogen. So by taking the nitrogen out of the air and combining it with the hydrogen from the wind, we then can produce green ammonia, which in the future will have a very high value. The European Union and all our goals is about the energy used on ground. But on top of that, we also need to solve all the energy use by planes and all the energy use by intercontinental ships. And for my country, those blocks, airplanes and ships, is almost as big as our entire domestic energy consumption. A Danish company, which is called Maersk Shipping, they're the largest container company in the world. And by having them becoming green, we need enormous amounts of green fuels. And some of the first demonstration projects will probably be home in Denmark, where they will test. This is not today. What I'm talking about, this drawing is the future. So please leave this room with the knowledge that this is not Denmark today. This is what we're talking about today. And we have biomethane check, and we have carbon extraction, carbon dioxide extraction check, and we have electrolyzers in small scale check, and our government wants to have large scale, and this one we don't have. We then see how the different end consumers can use different components and how you can add them together. Because the Dutch case where you saw electricity, methane, and hydrogen, in our small country, we already now also need to see where is the carbon dioxide. Because we can see that to produce this table, we need plastic. And in that plastic, we need to have carbons together with the hydrogen. So in our entire energy system, carbon dioxide will in the future be a product that we need a lot. It's not natural that we need to keep it, let's say, in steel tanks under high pressure, but it's a very high value product in the end, as will probably be nitrogen. So to solve the entire future picture of all the different energy uses, we need to have a look not only on gases or hydrogen, but also on other types. So in our strategy paper, we say that someone should start thinking about this. How should we take carbon dioxide in Denmark around? Should it be a commercial business? Should it be in pipes? Some of the biggest industrial sites, they are, let's say, clustered together. They have cities next to them. They have wind parks. So there might be, let's say, small carbon dioxide networks. And also ammonia. You can make an example. You can calculate how much ammonia you need to fuel Madrid Airport. And then you will suddenly see that you should have 100,000 of trucks coming with the ammonia, or you will have it in pipelines. So I guess that pipelines will be in business also. So for me, being a gas transmission system operator, we are also assessing, is there other services that we might transport in the future? I think only there are 4 slides left. This is also from Madrid Forum, which is also an interesting topic, and that's about what is green. And green is not the same as green. So this is a presentation which we made for the Madrid Forum, where we have, let's say, all the gas associations, distribution, transmission, try to, let's say, categorize which service source, natural gas, electricity from renewable energy, or electricity within the renewable energy directive, which is something else. So in fact, on renewable energy, we have a directive which says that something is in fact real green and something is not real green. Then we have the different technologies: anaerobic digestion for biomethane, pyrolysis, power to gas, photocatalyst, steam methane reforming. That's where you take the natural gas and extract the CO2, and then you have a blue hydrogen. Or you could make it, this is blue hydrogen in a very advanced SMR technology, where you can reduce 90% of the carbon. Here you only reduce 60%. So we made this for the commission to saying that it's wrong that the politician talks about fossil and green or decarbonized, because the decarbonized come in many different versions. And it's completely, not stupid, but it's very expensive to go from here to there. I'm neighboring to Poland. And in Poland, they have a lot of coal, which they are going to change away from. And they want to become green. So they have now made a new pipeline together with us, so they get natural gas. So they go from here, let's say, to here. And then a lot of Danish politicians and European Union members of parliament say, but why didn't Poland go to here? And then we made the calculation that for Poland, it's 4 times more expensive to go here today than it is to go here. And then the Polish delegation went back to Brussels, said to the commission, fine for us, so if the commission will fund the 3 times that we lack of money, then okay, then we might introduce more wind instead of having natural gas. And then for sure you know that that's not the case. So I also had this step ladder in the beginning that depending on how much renewable energy you have, you are in different stages of decarbonization or transition. And in my head, it's okay that you are fossil today, and then you, in some parts of the sector, start to decarbonize. You're taking the steps, decarbonizing. These technologies over here, which today is very, very expensive, they will then mature, the cost will come down, and then 5 years later, you can take the next step here, and then you can take the next step here. And then in the end, all of us need to be out here. Some of the countries, they even talk about more than 100% decarbonization that we will end by having CO2 as a byproduct, which we can sell to others. So we need to go out of this. And again, if you in Spain have not had the discussion between, could I call it the 50 shades of green? I know there's a very famous American movie or book which is called 50 Shades of Grey, which is something different. But we need to understand the different kinds of green in here. In my country, we are in this area here with the biomethane. But we had some biomethane production sites which was using partly methanized hydrogen. And then they wanted to invest and sell the biomethane to industries. But then the industries' lawyers came back. And they had discovered that there is a difference, that the type of biomethane they would get was not fulfilling the Renewable Energy Directive. And that meant that the industry said no to this biomethane because it was not legally green. But to some extent, it might be even greener than this, because all the electricity came from green electricity. Some of the electricity over here might come from black electricity when you, for instance, run your biomethane plant. So we had a legal product which was greener than the real green. This is the last slide. I don't know why they are there. I can show you all of these. So it's not just to come with some examples where we are. This is my own company. So on our homepage, this you can follow how the biomethane share is going up. This was from March this year. We are part of this Green Gas Initiative where we work together with other TSOs because we want to promote gas, green gas in mobility, power to gas, etc. In the other end, we are part of this North Sea Wind Power Hub, which is assessing 10 gigawatt offshore development of wind together with Netherlands and the European Commission. The intention is that there will be a lot of wind parks in the North Sea. And there will be so many that in the middle we will construct an artificial island, because in my country no one wants to have windmills outside their window. No one wants to have overhead lines crossing their cities. So to be able to reach 100% renewable electricity by 2030, we need to have it where people don't see it. It's offshore. So this could be the future. Again, we have calculated on this. And this is probably twice as expensive as if we do it onshore. So it might be that the politicians in the end will say, I don't care about the public opinion. We will put the facilities onshore. And then the intention is that Norway, Denmark, Germany, Netherlands, UK should have multiple islands, and then they should be connected. So there will be a transmission corridor of electricity offshore. We are part of that also. We work a lot together with the European organizations because, as I said, it's very important that we assist in, let's say, making the new regulatory framework. We have a PhD program because what happened? I don't know. It's not the case here in Denmark. No, it's not the case here in Spain, I can say. If I was in Denmark 5 years ago, there would be 2 female. Gas sector was 5 years ago boring and not non-interesting. So it would be old people and men. Then we saw 5 years ago, 4 years ago, when we had the biomethane coming, more and more applying for jobs were not interested in gas. They were interested in green gas and decarbonization. And people became younger and younger, and they became more and more equal in, let's say, whether they were male or female. That's not the reason why we made this PhD program, but we acknowledge that the level of knowledge we had in our heads, scientific proof for all we are going through the next 10 years is too little. You don't have papers about the future we are going to be in 2030. We don't have papers how the legal basis should be or the regulatory setup. So we need to also start an academic layer where we in fact use time to find the right solutions. So we, together with a lot of other companies, hydrogen, biomethane, we are sponsoring in Copenhagen PhDs. We have done it now for 3 years. It's in fact very interesting to go to this homepage. It's in English, and there you can see the studies they are doing, and they are very clever. I fear when they come out, they will take a lot of my job or other jobs because they are so clever. And also some of the positive aspects of the future lies in we find new answers here. It's young people, they are open-minded. For sure they will need elder people to guide them, so we still have job also in the future. I told you about this hydrogen test. It's this homepage, there you can go. So here you see that we have the transmission and distribution, and then we have the closed circle with an electrolyzer producing the hydrogen. Today, 15% hydrogen. Then this is our newest project, which we went into with Halter Topsø. And this is, let's say, outside our legal scope. Here we are assessing together with the Danish industry whether we can make ammonia out of electricity. And why is it important for us? Yeah, it's important for us because on me and us, we have a responsibility in the law to make a national energy plan and infrastructure plan. And I just showed you that the infrastructure will very soon include ammonia and nitrogen and carbon dioxide. And therefore, for me, it's natural that I use half an employee for this project. So we are assessing and following that, so we have the newest information. So when the government asks us, what's your feeling about ammonia and ammonia for shipping and airplanes, then we have some solid facts to stand on. If I was not part of this, I would wait and then I would read the reports. I wouldn't have the knowledge within my own company. Yes, so if I should repeat 3 of the main conclusions. The energy sector will be much more complex, and it will be fantastic to work with energy in the future. But we also need to be open-minded and just say what we did yesterday, it could be that we will do something else in the future. That's what I'm doing every day. Then it's about gas and power. I have the luck that I'm married with the power sector. I was even boss in the power TSO 10 years ago. And that is that the regulators and the TSO and the businesses, you need to talk to the power people as well. Make joint projects, start finding the same language. The good thing about you said there's only gas people in the room, so I can tell you what the really big benefit is, that because then the power sector will start finding out how difficult it will be for them to solve the 2050 problem. And they will come back asking for help from the gas sector. That's the case in my country. So it will be complex, and it will be focused on sector coupling between electricity and gas. And then I think perhaps dynamic regulation should be the third conclusion, and that is the gas package should not be very determined. It should be very opened. Every quarter, I'm wiser than I was 3 months ago, and it just continues. So if we make a gas package now, and we say we will have a new legislation because now we know how the markets will be, that's wrong. It's silly. We don't know how the markets will be. So there should be a dynamic regulation. Also, ACER is saying this, that instead of having very detailed regulation, you should have a more, let's say, block regulation, and then over time, the Commission or ACER and the member state should have the right to decide on more detailed solutions. Otherwise, we will either not have the regulatory support, or the regulatory support will be so detailed that we will only find this solution and not find the entire solution. I can talk for hours, but I decide to stop here. Thank you.
Thank you.